So my name is Marc Florbet, and I'm supposed to chair this morning session. And my job is to introduce our speaker this morning, Thomas Piketty. So of course, Thomas doesn't really know, doesn't really need any introduction. But nevertheless, I think we can all agree that he can be credited for having put the question of inequalities back at the forefront of public concerns, if not public policy, but at least it's a very important part of the public debate nowadays. And another thing that probably we can credit to Thomas is a revival of the interest in systemic issues of capitalism, broadly speaking. And now, among these systemic issues, there is a sort of external threat coming from the planetary boundaries, so there is no built-in mechanism in the market economy and in capitalism to take care of planetary boundaries and sustainability. And so it's indeed very relevant to introduce this consideration. Now, the talk today, if I understand well, given the title we have here, will combine these two concerns, inequality and sustainability. And this is interesting in itself. If you are familiar with the economic literature, until recently, the literature on sustainable growth paths, as well as the literature on climate policy, was hardly looking at inequality issues. So redistribution was, even by some authors, was adamantly considered to be belonging to another department of economics, the redistribution department, and not the distribution of the department of externalities and inefficiencies due to environmental problems. But there was a sort of inconsistency in this disregard for inequalities, because at the core of these issues of sustainability and climate policy was an issue of intergenerational inequality. All the debate about discounting in particular was about intergenerational equity. So there was a sort of inconsistency. Why focus so much on intergenerational inequalities while disregarding intragenerational inequalities? So I think Thomas will show us how we can get rid of this inconsistency. And without further ado, Thomas, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Marc. I'm not quite sure I'm going to respond to this specific concern, but certainly I'd be happy to answer questions. So yes, so this is the title of this talk, Inequality and Sustainability. I should make clear that two things right away, that, you know, when I talk about sustainability, this is, of course, about ecological, environmental sustainability, but also about social sustainability, political sustainability. And I, you know, I will make clear what I have in mind in a minute. And I will argue that the general issue of equality and sustainability that we have to face in the future, in some way we already faced it in the past with different concerns, which was maybe less ecological and more social, but we faced it to a large extent in a successful manner. And so there's a lot to learn from this experience. I should also strongly encourage you to attend the other keynote talk of the day by Luca Chancel on environmental inequalities. So, you know, part of what I'm going to present today comes from joint work with Luca Chancel at the World Inequality Lab on environmental inequalities, and you will get a lot more in Luca's talk. I also strongly encourage you to attend Julia Cage's talk this afternoon, which will be more about political inequality and inequality and political sustainability. I mean, can you sustain a democratic system basically with huge inequality? And you know, that's a big issue about inequality and democratic sustainability, if you want. So the three talks really sort of come together. You know, I will say a number of things in this talk today, but you know, there will be lots of missing points, and the specific point that Marc just raised is certainly part of the missing point. But you know, we can talk more about this later. I should say, you know, Marc, following your nice introduction, that I'm very happy that you are now at PSC. You know, it's been 3 years already, but I remember, you know, 30 years ago, much before you went to Princeton, you know, we were already talking a lot together about inequality, social justice, and there was a little group in Paris talking about these issues, and, you know, time has passed, but, you know, it's great to have you back here in the team. Okay, so let's start right away. So, you know, basically I'm going to make 3 points in the talk. So first point is going to be that, you know, sustainable development in the ecological sense in the 21st century will require, in my view, you know, in many people's view, a drastic compression in inequality. And the basic intuition is simply that lower and middle classes in the north, and even more so probably in the south, will never accept to change their lifestyle if we do not implement a massive reduction in top-end living standards, wealth concentration. So, and I will show you data, you know, showing that, you know, it's going to be very hard given the already very large inequality in carbon emission and relatively low level for lower groups and middle groups as compared to top groups. You know, any solution where you ask everybody for a proportional reduction with massive reduction at the bottom and the middle is very unlikely to convince anyone. Well, except if you have a very authoritarian system, but you know, I don't think this is going to happen. So that's you know, the bad news, if you want, or you know, the complicated news is that, you know, we'll have to solve environmental challenges together with inequality challenges. Now, the good news is that we've already done that in the past and we've been largely successful. And so I want to insist on this second point, you know, that sustainable development in the 19th century, 20th century, did already, you know, rely on a drastic reduction in inequality. And, you know, generally speaking, you know, the long run movement toward more political and socioeconomic equality that we observe in the long run played a central role in the rise of modern economic prosperity, political stability. So here, what I have in mind is sustainability through, you know, more equal access to education, more equal access to economic opportunity, more equal access to voting rights, political rights. And, you know, this very large movement toward more equality was absolutely central, you know, to produce the kind of political stability, rule of law that was absolutely indispensable for development, but also the educational investment, the public infrastructure investment that delivered development. Now, this didn't happen easily, you know, because many people and, of course, many of the elite groups were against this reduction in inequality. But in the end, it was a very successful experience. And so, in a way, what I want to claim is that the challenge we have to face in the, you know, in the future, we've already faced sort of similar challenges in the past, and although we do not always see it this way, you know, I think that's important to give this historical perspective in order to address the challenge of the future. And indeed, the third point of the talk, quite obviously, is that there is a lot to learn from the past trajectories toward more equality. So, you know, one story about how more equality happened is through crises and wars and World War I and World War II. But, you know, this is a very pessimistic view of how things happened, which actually I don't share. You know, I think, I'm not saying crises and wars didn't play any role. You know, they did, obviously, they accelerated certain changes. And sometimes they produce major catastrophes most of the time. But in any case, you know, these shocks, I feel are not necessary, are not sufficient in themselves. And the key force really behind the rise of equality in 19th, 20th century was a political process. And to put it clearly, you know, the rise of the labor movement and the successful political mobilization around what you can call the social democratic platform, you know, rise of the social state and welfare state, democratization of education, progressive taxation, you know, this policy agenda, which was not obvious at all a century ago, you know, at the end of the 19th century, if you had told, you know, the economic elite or political elite or mainstream economists of the time, you know, you're going to have a welfare state making 50% of GDP by the end of the 20th century, you know, people would have never believed it as of 1900, 1910. So, you know, these things came through major political mobilization. And, you know, in a way, what we need for the future is a new form of social democratic platform. I prefer to refer to democratic socialism. Some people would prefer to talk about social democracy. I mean, to me, these are synonymous terms. What matters in the end is really the content. And we will talk about the content and what could be the next step for the sort of social democratic platform with, of course, a much stronger environmental perspective, and also a much more global perspective than 20th century social democracy, which was very much centered on nation states, and in particular the richest nation states of the North. And that's a big limitation. And, you know, we'll see through the you know the data, I will show you how we can think about this next step. So some of the material I will show you comes from this book, A Brief History of Equality, which some of you might already be familiar with. I'm also going to present some material from the World Inequality Report 2022, which you can find easily online on this website. I will also present some new material from this project on environmental inequality and you know historical and comparative that has been developed at the World Inequality Lab, in particular with Lucas Chancel, who will present more material in his own talk later this morning. Okay, so let's start right away. I'm going to start with a sort of worldview of what we know about inequality, starting with income inequality, wealth inequality, and then moving to environmental inequality, starting from the perspective of the World Inequality Report and then moving on to a more historical perspective. So I will start with a snapshot of sort of today's situation and move on to the long run perspective. So the data from the World Inequality Report comes from mostly from the World Inequality Database, which is available online. And so here I'm only going to show you a few examples of the data, but you know you can go online and find a lot more. So let me start with what was the starting point of the World Inequality Database, which was about income inequality. So here you have a world map with one simple indicator of income inequality, which is the share going to the top 10% of the population. And just to get the orders of magnitude in perspective, you know, if you had complete equality, the top 10% share should be 10%, because after all, they are 10% of the population, so they should have 10% of income. If you had complete inequality, they should have 100%. So in practice, it's always between 10 and 100. The point is that it varies quite a lot. It goes, you know, almost from 20 to 70, say 25 to 65, 70. So, you know, it's not from 10 to 100, but it's, you know, it's quite significant. The most equal country will be in Western Europe or Nordic Europe, where it will be 25-30%. In the back to the early 80s, it was as low as 20-22%. You know, in some Nordic countries now it's more 25-30. But okay, it's this order of magnitude. The most unequal country in our database right now will be South Africa with 67% for the top 10. Brazil or Mexico will be quite close, you know, 60-65. India, almost 60. So if we want to get a sort of big picture, the countries in the south tend to be more unequal. Countries in the north tend to be more equal, in particular Europe. And even, you know, North America or Japan, although they are less equal than Europe, you know, as compared to South Africa or Brazil or India, you know, they tend to be relatively more equal. So that's first point, is lots of variation across the world map, and countries in the north tend to be more equal. Second point is it's not always been like that. So in fact, if you look, so we will go back through history a bit later, but basically if you go back one century ago, Europe will be, it will not be exactly South Africa, but it will be close to Latin America. So, you know, the top 10% share will be 50 to 60%, you know, depending on the European countries. So, you know, and the reason why it has moved from 50, 60% for the top 10 to say 30%, 25, 30% for the top 10 is through this political process, you know, I was describing before. And it's a major transformation. You know, it did not happen just like this. And it was actually very good for development and for prosperity. And, you know, it came with the highest period of growth rate and productivity improvements that we've seen in history. Because, you know, I will argue, you know, the rise of more equality also brought more equal access to education, more equal access to economic opportunities in general. And, you know, by and large, this was a very positive. But this did not happen just like this. You know, this happened through major political mobilization. So this is, if you take the top 10% share, maybe what's even more striking is if you take the bottom 50% share. So by definition, the missing share goes to the 40% in between the top 10 and the bottom 50. If you go on the website, you will see everything by percentile and even the tens of percentile. Here, I just give sort of the big order of magnitude for the big top 10%, bottom 50% share. So let's look at the order of magnitude for the bottom 50% share. So again, you know, if you had complete equality, you should have 50% of total income for the bottom 50%. If you had complete inequality, you should have zero. What do you have? Well, in practice, it doesn't go from 0 to 50, but it goes from 5 to 25. So you know, the highest shares for the bottom 50% will be again in Nordic Europe, where it will be around 25%. The lowest share will be again South Africa with about 5%, and in Brazil, in Latin America in general, it will be 5 to 10%. So by the way, when I say, you know, Latin America, you know, in every region of the world, you have lots of variation. So you can see Argentina is a bit more equal than Brazil, Chile, or Mexico. And this is to be put in relation to a different political trajectory with something a bit more like a European welfare state built under Peronism. I mean, it's certainly not perfect, etc. But I mean, there are big variations in every region. So there will be a lot to say about each country on this map, which I'm not going to get into. But by and large, the lowest bottom 50% shares are, say, in Brazil, Mexico, it will be 5 to 10%. In South Africa, 5%. In Nordic Europe or Western Europe, 20 to 25%. What I want to stress is, the enormous difference that it makes in terms of basic poverty and basic capabilities and access to food, access to housing, access to health, access to very basic goods and services. Basically, you know what this means. So, you know, just to get the orders of magnitude, you know, when you are the bottom 50%, you have 25% of total income in your country. It means that on average, your average income is about half of the average income of the entire country. So of course you are poorer than average. You know, after all, you are the bottom 50%, but you are not hugely poorer than average. You are not, you know, the distance, economic distance, and also social distance, political distance, you know, in a way is not completely crazy. You know, whereas if you have 5% of total income and you are 50% of the population, it means your average income is only 1/10 of average income of your country. So you are, you know, very, very far away from the average of your country, not to mention the very rich, of course. But so this is, you know, this has very concrete consequences, and you can imagine, you can see in terms of poverty. So if you're interested in absolute poverty, for instance, that, you know, what this means also is that inequality is going to matter enormously, because for a given average income, or for a given, you know, GDP per capita, the average income of the bottom 50% can vary by a factor of 1 to 5, depending on the level of inequality. So if you only look at macro aggregates, I have a lot of interest for macro aggregates and a lot of sympathy for my friends, macroeconomists in the room. But you know, that's not going to be enough, because you're going to miss, you know, differences in average income for the bottom 50% of the population of a factor of 1 to 5. So, you know, this illustrates, you know, how important it is to look at inequality. This also illustrates, so again, if we look at the historical evolution, I will show you a more specific example later, but Europe today has 20-25% of total income for the bottom 50%. So this is taking into account, I should say, most monetary transfer, because pension, unemployment transfer are here, but you have some in-kind transfers that are not taken into account. So we have already also a series taking into account income, in-kind transfer, in which case the bottom 50% share will be even higher, may I say maybe between 25 and 30% rather than between 20 and 25%. So this is the situation in Europe today. But it has not always been like that. So again, if we go back through time, in the early 20th century or late 19th century, it was closer to 10%, you know, like in Latin America today. So there's been an enormous transformation over time regarding the reduction of the top share, but even more importantly, the increase in the bottom shares with enormous consequences in average living standard. So this is about income inequality. Now, let me move to wealth inequality. Which is, well, the bottom line is that wealth inequality is always a lot higher than income inequality. So here I have put you sort of regional averages. You can also see the country data online. So this is a figure that comes from the World Inequality Report 2022, but you can get detailed data by country online. Generally speaking, you know, in our approach at the World Inequality Lab is that we tend to vary, you know, the
sort of geographical unit that we use to look at inequality. So sometimes we look at country or even sometimes subnational level department in France or states in the US. Sometimes we look at big region. Sometimes we look at the entire world, treating everybody as an individual citizen. I think all perspectives are interesting and meaningful. And, you know, we should not just pick one or another. They deliver different insights. So here we look at big regional or continental averages. So here the bottom line is, okay, in terms of wealth inequality, Europe is more equal, again, than the rest of the world. But, you know, it's still very unequal. So if you take the bottom 50% share, you know, in Europe, this is 4% of total wealth. So, you know, in Latin America, it would be 1%. So yes, 4% is a lot more than 1%, four times more. But, you know, for 50% of the population, this is not a lot. Okay. And so you can see the difference with income, which is that here, there's basically no part of the world where the bottom 50% has a meaningful share of wealth. It's always very small, you know, usually less than 5%, 2% in the US, 4% in Europe. Now, still, the what we call here the middle 40%, which is not really the middle because it's above the median by definition, it's in between the bottom 50 and the top 10, has a significant share. And we will see that this is really what has increased in the long run. But, you know, the top 10% share is still very high everywhere. Now, why is wealth important and not just income? You know, I think wealth is important because it is in some way a better measure of your, I mean, economists would say of your permanent income, or at least your permanent capacity to take long-term decisions, to face economic shocks. I think, you know, it's also a better indicator of your bargaining power in general vis-à-vis the rest of society and vis-à-vis your own life. So basically, you know, if you have no wealth at all, you know, or if you only have debt, you know, you have very limited bargaining power. So you have to accept anything. You have to accept any job, working condition, wage, because you need to pay for your rent. And you need, if you have a family, you need to pay for your family. You know, you cannot really discuss anything. If you have just a little bit of wealth, so, you know, if you look at this, you know, if you think of this middle 40% group, you know, in Europe, they have about almost 40% of total wealth. So again, you know, you should always try to make the computation of what it means in terms of concrete numbers. If you are 40% of the population and you have about 40% of total wealth, it means that on average, you have about the average wealth of the country in which you are, which in Western Europe today will be about 200,000 euros net wealth per adult. So, you know, real estate plus financial asset plus business assets minus debt, you will be around 200,000 euros per adult. So these people, you know, the green bar will be people who have 100,000 euros per adult, 200, 300, you know, these are people in this range. So this is a group of the population that is not enormously rich individually. And, you know, from the point of view of billionaires or millionaires, you know, having 100,000 euros or zero is the same thing, basically. But in fact, it's not the same thing. So because when you have 100, 200, 300, you know, you can start up a company, if you're a little firm, if you want, you can buy an apartment. Okay, maybe not in Paris, but, you know, in most part of the country, and in most countries, you know, most people don't live in Paris or don't live in London or Manhattan, and you can actually buy a home, or you can have a little loan in complement to buy a home, and then you are in a better security for your life, for your family. You can take risk more. I think it's largely positive. I think the rise of this patrimonial middle class, which did not exist 1 century ago, is positive. Then the key question is, can we go even further in this direction? And I will return to this later. But, you know, that's the big picture about wealth. And, you know, keep in mind, you know, income is important, consumption is important. Wealth is also very important in terms of, you know, economic opportunities, bargaining power that individuals have. Another dimension of inequality, which was introduced in the World Inequality Database in recent years, was gender inequality, and then I will move to environmental inequality. In terms of gender inequality, here we have a very simple indicator, which is the share of total labor income, you know, including self-employment income, going to women. So, you know, if you look at time use survey, how much time do you spend working, you know, including domestic labor, women always have 50% or more of total working time after you introduce domestic labor. So you could say, 50% after all could be the target, or even better, or even more than this. In practice, you can see that you are quite far. So, even in Western Europe, it used to be 30% back in 1990. Today, it's 35-36%, which means that the men are getting 65-64%. So, almost twice as much, not quite as men in terms of women, in terms of monetary income. Now, of course, this puts together participation effect and the fact that for a given job and given occupation, you don't get the same wage, and the fact that you don't access to the same occupation. So it puts together lots of effects, but we believe, it's important to look at this big picture, because if you only look at the gender gap for a given occupation and you say, okay, there's a gender gap of 10% or 12%, you are in a way understating the extent of the problem, because the whole thing is that women and men don't have access to the same occupation for all sorts of reasons, which have to do with discrimination, which have to do with a lot of prejudice or a lot of inequality in who takes care of the children, etc. So in the end, at the end of the day, this big picture is important. So this is improving in certain parts of the world. Western Europe in 1970, we don't have it here, but in 1970, it would have been 20% of total labor income from women. So 1960, 1970 was really the highest point of the sort of breadwinner model and sort of patriarchal culture in the West. And at that time, it was like 20% only of monetary, labor income going to women. So basically 80% would go to men. So issues about money are issues for men, and women, are not really involved in this. Now, Middle East and North Africa today is between 10 and 20%, but it's not so far from Western Europe in 1970, but it's even less. You can see China, a decline, which is quite unique. Now, what's happening here is two things. Well, first, China, like most communist countries, starts from a relatively high level of labor share for women. That's the first point. The second point is that what happened in recent decades with the rise of very top wages, including in China, is really going in the direction of giving a bigger share of total wage to men, because most top 1% wage earners or top managers in China are men. You can just look at a picture of Chinese CEOs or Chinese elite politicians. There's no woman at all, obviously. So if you increase the relative income at the top, you tend to increase the share of men. Now, in the West, there was also this increase in the top income, but there were other factors, including increasing labor force participation by women, which initially was less than in a communist country like China, which have counteracted this top 1% factor. But in China, this top factor has been the dominant effect. Okay, so you have this variation. Now, let me move to the latest dimensions that we've included in the database, which is really directly about ecological sustainability, which is about the distribution of carbon emission within countries and within different parts of the world. So, when we look at inequality in carbon emission, we typically look at inequality between countries, and we stress, the large gap between the average emission in the north and average emission in the south, and the south is going to suffer for most of the damage of the accumulated emission of the north, and that's of course completely true. But it's also important to stress the enormous inequality within each part of the world. So here, the way the data was constructed is by using household expenditure survey to measure the carbon content of the different consumption level and investment patterns. So consumption and investment are distributed in proportion to their carbon content and in the proportion by decile of who is how much the different decile and percentile are consuming and investing. And Luca will tell you more about some of the issues on how you take into account investment, consumption, ownership, and there are lots of interesting discussion about this. I'd be happy to answer if there are questions, but basically that's what we do here. What you can see is if you take Europe, the bottom 50% of the population is Europe right now has a per capita emission of 5.1 ton of carbon equivalent per year, which is too much. You know, it should go toward 2 or 3 in the coming decades, according to official commitments taken by European countries. But, you know, 5 is not completely out of line with the objective of getting toward 4 or 3 or 2, or at least, you know, you are in the same order of magnitude and you can think that you can go there. Now, the problem is that if you look at the upper group, so you take the top 10%, average emission is going to be 29. If you look at top 1%, it's going to be 70 or 80. In North America, already the average emission of the top 10% is 73. So, you know, that's going to be, you know, I think, you know, any policy that ignores inequality in carbon emission is going to have a very hard time addressing this concern. So basically, if you come to your population and you say, okay, you know, everybody will have to cut their carbon emission by the same proportional amount, you know, through a gigantic proportional carbon tax or through a gigantic increase in energy prices, and, you know, this is what will happen, and this is what you have to do. You know, I think people, you know, you're going to have gigantic yellow vest movement everywhere, basically. So, you know, people in the bottom groups will tell you, well, look, you know, okay, maybe I need to change my lifestyle a little bit, but, you know, first, I don't have public transportation. I need to take my car to go to work. And next, you have these people at the top, you know, who take an airplane to go for a weekend in Rome. And, you know, what are you doing with them? And actually, they're exempt from the carbon tax that you're asking me to pay. So, you know, at some point, it's just not going to work. So, you know, I think no government, no democratic government, either in France or anywhere in the world, is going to be able to do this. So, you know, the only way you can sort of convince people at the bottom that they need to change, and of course they need to change because you cannot rely only on the reducing the emission at the top, you will have to start by trying to convince your population that the distribution of the burden of adjustment is equitable. So it's complicated to define equity. You have intergenerational, intragenerational, but you have to try, and you have to try very hard, and it cannot just be pretending. You know, you have to show sort of concrete signs that indeed, you know, in proportion, you're asking a much bigger effort at the top than at the bottom. And this is, you know, I think people still don't realize this completely. You know, they are still, you know, in the world, you know, remember the attempt of increasing the carbon tax in 2017-18 in France. You know, there were lots of competent people that were advising for this policy and saying that's good, let's do it, etc. You know, without taking into account the fact that it's socially unacceptable, you know, in terms of distribution of effort and who's making the biggest effort. And in the end, it's politically unsustainable. And so you have you run into a major problem of sustainability, taking into account the social and political dimension, and, you know, getting away from the sort of representative agent perspective, which I think is not adequate at all to study this kind of issues. Now, it's also important, so this is the sort of intra-country inequality perspective. It's also important, of course, to have the between-country and historical perspective on, you know, historical responsibilities regarding climate change. And so this is a graph, you know, that comes from research by Lucas Chancel on the sort of historical evolution of energy consumption across parts of the world, you know, putting together lots of data that has been compiled by various environmental experts, but there's also quite a lot of new data in there. What I want to stress here is really, I think, quite important and sometimes neglected in the public discussion is that basically, if you look at per capita emission, which is the only meaningful way, you know, to compare responsibilities between countries, because, you know, I know people in France like to say we are a very small country, China is very big, therefore, you know, there's no point making any effort because the Chinese are going to pollute everything. But, you know, if the Swiss were telling that to the French and saying, okay, we can keep driving, but you stop driving because we are a small country, you know, people in France will hardly accept it. So this makes no sense. You know, at some point, the basic principle of equity, which would be, you know, we have to look at per capita emission, otherwise, you know, we really get into big problems. Now, if you look at per capita emission, the very striking thing is that countries in the West, you know, have been emitting a lot, to summarize. So if you look in particular at the Trente Glorieuse, as we say in France, you know, 1950, 1980, European countries were at about 15 tons per carbon equivalent of emission per capita, 10 to 15, but closer to 15, including France, you know, because sometimes there's also some storytelling about, you know, France did not do that. Okay, yeah, well, in fact, it's the same order of magnitude. In the US, it was, you know, 20, 25, 30 during this period. So now this has been declining in recent years. So, you know, when we say, you know, we have a 50% reduction or a 30% reduction in emissions, you know, we are always comparing to the peak around 1980 or 1990. So as compared to the peak, yes, you have a decline in emission. But, you know, starting from a very high level. And so if you look at China in particular, you know, you have a big increase in emission. So India is still at 2, 3, 4 tons per individual. China is now getting close to 10. If you look at the very recent year and the projection for the coming years, Europe and China will be very close. So, by the way, you know, sometimes you can see some data that is published saying that China is already above Europe in terms of per capita emission. That's only if you don't do the import-export correction. Okay, so here we do import-export correction, so we attribute to the European consumers the goods that they consume, and even if it's imported and produced in China, and you know that's what puts Europe still a little ahead of China. But in any case, you know, the point is that if we believe the official projection of China, and you know, I think they are about okay, you know, probably a bit optimist, but probably they will never really go above 10. So they will, you know, in their development trajectory, they will stay around 10. They will never get to the kind of 15 or 20, 25 that the West had during their own development trajectory. So in other words, you know, the historical responsibility in terms of per capita emission will never be probably as large in any country in the world except as compared to what it was in Europe and the US. Now, of course, you can say, well, that's because the technology at the time in Europe were not available. Awareness of climate change was not the same as today. That's all very true. And, you know, that's not saying that, you know, Europeans are bad and Chinese are good. You know, that would be ridiculous. It's a different historical circumstances. But at the end of the day, you know, it's still the point is that the Western countries, you know, became rich through this emission. So it's, you know, it's not our fault individually. We, you know, we were not responsible for these choices, but this is how our countries became rich. And so, you know, we are not responsible for what was done 50 years ago, but we are responsible for how we analyze the world today. And if we choose not to take into account that these countries became rich through this extra emission, you know, I think we put ourselves into trouble if we pretend that we are building sort of universal norms of justice and equity, etc. So that's something, you know, which I think is very important to have in mind, which is sometimes completely neglected in the public discussion. You know, of course, a big part of the public discussion is obscured by, you know, if you compare aggregate emission, you multiply by population. So, of course, with the huge Chinese population, you have you get big numbers. Also, you know, Chinese population is going to decline, and at the end of the 21st century, will be less than the combined population of Europe and the US. So, you know, even in terms of population, you know, things are more complicated than we sometimes imagine. But, you know, I think there are good reasons for focusing also, and most importantly, on the per capita. Now, in terms of how this translates into total inequality of carbon emission, so here it's a simple indicator looking at the share of total emission emitted by the top 10% emitters of the world. So here we look at all world citizens individually. We put them together into a single distribution. So you can see that the top 10% share has declined a little bit in recent decades, you know, from 50, 55% to 45%. That's because of the decline in the rich countries' per capita emission to a large extent. But, you know, it's still very unequal. You still have 45-50% of emission for the top 10 and only 10% for the bottom 50. So, you know, it's very unequal. And even more spectacular to show it is to compare the bottom 50% share and the top 1%, which are roughly the same order of magnitude. So, you know, we don't pretend that the data is perfect. There's lots of limitations in the data, but we believe the orders of magnitude are meaningful. And in particular, the fact that, you know, bottom 50% and top 1% have roughly the same contribution to aggregate emission is the right order of magnitude. And, you know, that's important because, you know, sometimes in the public discussion, you have some people who say, okay, you know, we don't care about what the top 1% is emitting because, you know, this is a very small minority. You're not going to solve any problem with this. Okay, you're not going to solve every problem with this, that's for sure. But, you know, it's not completely, you know, negligible. Basically, it's the same as was the bottom 50% of the world is emitting. So if you care about the carbon budget for development in India, in sub-Saharan Africa, you know, in the countries that will need to emit a little bit in the coming decades, you know, this is the same as the current carbon budget of the top 1%. So you can choose to ignore this if you want because it's complicated politically, etc. But then you cannot pretend you are interested in the orders of magnitude and the big macro numbers of, you know, that we have about climate change. Okay, so that's, you know, this is the sort of first part of the talk where I really wanted to stress about the picture about inequality today and then taking some more historical perspective on the environmental inequality regarding carbon emissions. Now, what I want to do in the rest of the talk is come back in history and try to show you, you know, how, you know, the evolution toward more equality took place in the past, and you know, what lessons we can draw for these challenges that we have to face in the future. Because, you know, again, you know, I think these environmental challenges will, you know, will be impossible to solve them without addressing at the same time the social and economic challenges in terms of distribution of economic resources in general. So here, you know, I'm gonna show you some results from my brief history of equality. So sorry, some of you maybe have already seen that, but I will try to present a few new additional results. So this book itself is a sort of summary, much shorter, of Capital and Ideology, which is, you know, like 1,200 pages long. And so I have written three big books on the history of inequality, you know, in the past, you know, this one in 2001, 2013, 2019. So together they are like 3,000 pages. So, you know, you can read them if you want, but, you know, it's a lot of pages. This one is 200 pages, 250. And I think it's, in the end, it's a much better book than the three others. At least it's clearer. And so, you know, I think I'm making progress over time, partly through the kind of discussion we're going to have today, to a large extent. And, you know, I think this book is sort of clearer. In particular, I really, as the title of the book indicates, I try in this book to emphasize this sort of positive and optimistic perspective about the long run evolution of toward more equality through political mobilization. Which I think in the end is sort of the most important lesson of this entire research program. I mean, there are also lots of other lessons, but you know, I have you know, by writing a shorter book, you have to ask yourself, you know, what's the most important message? And you know, I think this is the positive part on this. So it's a short book, but it has already, you know, 10 chapters, about 20 pages each. So, you know, you can read it quite quickly. There are topics that I won't touch about today, in particular the question of reparation and post-colonial reparation, the issue of Haiti, for instance, you know, the huge debt that was paid by Haiti to France between 1825 and the 1950s to compensate French slave owners for their loss of property. So, you know, the equivalent of 300% of GDP of 1825 was paid back to France during almost one century and a half. And, you know, I think it's a clear case where, you know, the reparation, you know, will make sense. And so today that would be, you know, the equivalent of, if we take the same 300% of GDP, not even counting the accumulated interest, that would be 30 billion euro transfer to Haiti. So, you know, only 1% of French public debt, so very, very small, but it would make a big difference for Haiti. Okay, so there's a whole discussion about reparation, post-colonial issues in general. I'd be happy to answer questions if you have questions. That's not what I'm going to focus on today. So what I'm going to focus on today is the long-run movement toward more equality, in particular in rich countries, and the lessons we can draw for how we can get to even more movement toward equality in the 21st century in relation to the ecological crisis. So let me first show you, you know, what we have for income distribution. So as you can see, so, you know, this is already what I've shown you with the world map earlier. So remember, the top 10% share in income today is about 30-35% in a country like France. In Nordic Europe, it will be more 25-30%. And if you were to take into account in-kind transfer, it would be a bit less than 30% in France today. So this is quite a lot less than the 50% you had until World War I, basically, and in the 19th century. And the bottom 50% share, you know, it used to be 10 to 12%, and now it's 20, 25%. If you take into account in-kind transfer, it would be even a bit higher than 25%. So, you know, there's a clear movement in the long run toward more equality, which happens through, we will see, you know, the rise of the welfare state in particular, lots of policy decisions to redistribute income. But, you know, in the end, it did happen. You know, it's really quite spectacular. So, you know, you have a stabilization at the end of the period. But, you know, if you look at the long run picture, you know, it's quite impressive, you know, this movement toward more equality, which came together in the 20th century with the fastest period of economic growth, economic prosperity ever observed, you know, in history. So this is for income inequality, and this is quite, I think, quite spectacular. Now, if you look at the same picture for wealth inequality, it's less spectacular in the sense that, so this is what I've told you before. If you look at the bottom 50%, we have about 5 to 6% of total wealth going to the bottom 50% in France today. It used to be 2% in the 19th century. This is an improvement, but it's a very small improvement for 50% of the population. I should say I'm showing here the data for France because we have exceptionally good historical data starting with the French Revolution, with very good inheritance archives in particular that we've collected with Gilles Postelvinet, Jean-Laurent Rosenthal, lots of colleagues. But we have similar series for Sweden, for Britain, for a number of European countries, and we get the same broad picture. I will show you a little bit of data for Sweden and Britain later, but you know, you should take these big evolutions that I show you for France as relatively representative of Western Europe. So to summarize, you know, quite a lot of progress in terms of income distribution, in terms of wealth distribution. Well, you know, there's still, you know, you have some progress in the sense that you have the rise of this middle class, you know, sort of patrimonial middle class. So remember, I told you about this group before, you know, this 40% of the population who today have about 40% of total wealth. So these are the people, you know, who have 100,000 euros, 200, 300. And you know, it's a big difference as compared to the 19th century, where the wealth share of this group was only, you know, 10 to 15%. So, you know, they were richer than the bottom 50% by definition, because they are the next 40%, but they were not hugely richer. So in the end, it's as if there was no middle class in a way, in the sense that the middle class in terms of wealth level was not very different from the bottom 50%. So you will go directly from the world of the bottom 90% to the world of the top 10 or top 1 who own almost everything. Okay? And you know, within, so here I'm showing you the top 10. Within the top 10, the share of the top 1 will be 50, almost 60, or even close to 70% in Paris in 1913. But for the whole of France, it would be between 50 and 60%. So, you know, within this group of the top 10, the top 1 is enormous. But if you look at this, you know, what's really striking in the long run, probably the most important development in the long run, is the rise of this patrimonial middle class, which I think, you know, it's a big progress. I mean, the fact that you have this group in the middle of the distribution, you know, who own 100, 200, 300,000 euros, you know, is also, you know, came with a more dynamic economy, more people who are able to build a home, to start up a firm, to be more active, and more, you know, have more capacity to take decision economically. And, you know, this is an enormous, and, you know, the fact that there was this decline in the top 10% share. So, you know, many people in 1900, 1910 will say, no, you don't want to have this decline at the top because it's absolutely necessary to have this concentration of wealth and investment opportunity at the top. Well, you know, at the end of the day, there was a huge reduction of the share at the top, and you know, the sky did not fall, the economy did not fall. Quite the opposite, there was more economic growth in the 20th century than ever before, and you know, I think the rise of the middle class in terms of wealth share is part of the story, and all the micro level studies we have about credit constraint, liquidity constraint, etc., suggest that, you know, this sort of more equal distribution of wealth contributed to economic prosperity. Now, you can also see that starting in the 1980s, you have an increase in the top 10% share, a slight decline in the bottom, in the middle 40% share. Now, in France, it's not huge, but it's still quite you know, an important turning point as compared to the previous decade. If you were to look in the US, you know, the middle 40% share will go down towards 30%, from about 40 to about 30%, and the top 10% will go up from 50 towards 65-70%. So it will be much more meaningful, and with the feeling that the middle class is really under threat. And you know, as a group, you know, I think also in France, you have the feeling that, you know, your sort of share is gradually eroding, or at least has stopped increasing. So typically, when you compare your situation to your parents and you look at your children and you feel, okay, I have become a homeowner as compared to my parents, so I have improved, you know, in terms of in the wealth distribution, but my children, maybe they will not even be able to have a home. So you feel, you know, the evolution of the situation has tilted in the wrong direction. I also think that this simple reality that we have today as compared to the early 20th century has huge political consequences. So, you know, the middle 40% group is made of people who own 100,000 euros, 200, 300, typically their home or little business. You know, they are not very rich people, but they are not completely poor. They don't like to be treated like poor. And I think that's part of the reason why you have also the division of the electorate, you know, between the urban poor, the rural poor. So you have more people in the countryside or in the rural areas who are homeowners. So you can be, you know, in the middle 40% in terms of wealth, but in the bottom 50% in terms of income, whereas the urban poor can be typically in the bottom 50% in terms of wealth, but in the middle 40% in terms of income, but then they have a very high rent to pay, so they don't necessarily have a very high living standard. And in terms of who votes for whom, you know, I think that's part of the situation that we have today politically, and not only in France. So I think, you know, this has also consequences for the political the political situation. So now, how did we move toward more equality in these two dimensions? First, you know, I really want to stress that, you know, before World War I, you know, there was really extreme concentration of wealth pretty much all across Europe. So, you know, that's France, Britain, Sweden. Now, it's interesting because, you know, in France in 1914, you know, France was always, you know, at least the French elite at the beginning of the Third Republic were always trying to present France as a very equal country. You know, the story was always, you know, we are not aristocratic Britain. We have made the French Revolution. We are a country of equals. We don't need progressive tax. You know, that was a big subject of the day. And indeed, France was the very last country to adopt the income tax in the summer of 1914, and it was not to invest in schools. It was to go to war with Germany. This is the only thing that convinced the French Senate to adopt the income tax. And whereas it had been adopted a long time before in Britain, in Sweden, in Prussia, in even in the US, you know, everywhere basically except France. And the big argument of the French elite at the time was, again, you know, we are a country of equal. We are already so equal. You know, why do you need a progressive income tax? And, you know, the first time I looked at the inheritance data in Paris and then for the whole of France in 1913, I was really shocked by these findings. And you know, at the same time, I was reading books by economists of 1900, 1910, you know, having all this discourse about egalitarian France, of course, with no data at all, you know, just. You know, there was even a famous professor at Collège de France at the time, Leroy Beaulieu, who was famous for writing books about the tendency toward more equality and France being more equal than everywhere else in the world, with no data at all, of course. And then you find this, and you know, for me, this was quite a shocking discovery in the sense that, you know, we need to be careful about what we say. We need to try to measure what we talk about, and you know, we should try today not to make the same mistake and, you know, illusion about you know, exceptional equality of France, etc., that we tend to do. Sweden is also a very interesting case because, you know, today we tend to look at Sweden as, you know, very equal, as if it was something, you know, natural, you know, like in the Swedish culture. Well, in fact, for a long time, Sweden was one of the most unequal countries in Europe and in the world. And, you know, in 1900, 1910, inequality in Sweden was built on a system, on an incredible system of political inequality. So only the top 10% men property owners could vote, which is a sort of standard feature in the 19th century, but 1910 is a bit late in the day to have this kind of system. But what's even more interesting is that within this top 20% group, you could have between 1 and 100 voting rights, depending on how wealthy you are. Okay, so, you know, very sophisticated. And in the municipal election, you had no upper ceiling on the number of votes you could have. It could keep rising with your level of wealth and tax you pay. And so you had several dozen municipalities in Sweden where only one individual had more than 50% of the vote. And so, could, you know, was basically a completely legal dictator. Corporations had the right to vote in municipal election in Sweden at the time on the basis of the capital invested in the municipality. So, you know, this is something multinational today would love to have, you know, when they invest in Nigeria or India, etc. But, you know, and sometimes they find other ways to get the same outcome, of course. But at least they don't even try to ask for that. You know, you know, it has become something you cannot ask for, you know, because it will be viewed as completely crazy if you ask for such a system today. Well, this was Sweden in 1910, okay? So when we talk about the culture of equality, we have to be aware that it's, you know, these things change over time, and they change through political mobilization. So in the case of Sweden, you know, the really interesting story is that, you know, at the same time, you had a working class in Sweden that was relatively educated for the time, for all sorts of historical reasons, large manufacturing sector, Protestantism, all sorts of various factors. You know, the working class was very angry with this situation. The trade union, the Social Democratic Party mobilized. They got universal suffrage around 1920. They took power in 1932. They stayed in power for half a century. They were re-elected. And they put the state capacity of Sweden to the service of a completely different project. So they used the same registration system for income and wealth, but instead of distributing voting rights in proportion of income and wealth, they made people pay very high progressive tax as a function of income and wealth to pay for an education and health system, which, you know, maybe is not perfect. You know, we've seen the limits with the pandemics, etc. But, you know, it's much better than everything else we had seen before. So, you know, it's a clear example where, you know, the state capacity, the administrative capacity of the state, you know, can be put to the service of very different projects. And so the state is not good or bad in itself. It's not equal or unequal in itself. You know, it depends on who controls the state and to do what. And so, you know, I think we really have to start from these lessons to understand, you know, how things can also change in the future. Because, you know, this is a clear example where the critical issue was not so much World War I or World War II, you know, which was not very important in a country like Sweden. It is much more the sort of internal political mobilization within a country. You know, of course, the people were confronted to a situation of extreme inequality and extreme unfairness, if you want. So, you know, there are reasons to, you need strong reasons to mobilize. But, you know, I think the kind of unfairness we are going to have at the global level today with, you know, global warming and the, you know, very negative consequences that we'll see already today, in particular in countries in the south, you know, is also going to be a very strong mobilizing factor. Now, Mark is telling me that I have 5 minutes, so I probably need to speed up a little bit, and that's what I'm going to do. Just to say, okay, this was the situation before before World War I. This is how this has changed. So, you know, Europe 1913, Europe 2020. Now we have this middle 40%, which has a significant share. In the US, you know, this middle class is now below 30%, you know, to about 25% of total wealth. So this has been declining, but, you know, this is showing the, you know, the limited progress toward less concentrated wealth. So how was progress toward more equality achieved? I already told you, you know, most of the story, in particular in relation to Sweden. Just to put it on a graph, you know, the rise of the welfare state, or more generally the social state, was you know, the most important factor. So here, this is the average of Germany, France, Britain, and Sweden. You have variation across countries, but by and large, you have the same picture in these four countries. So this is total tax revenue, combining all forms of taxation, direct, indirect, social contribution. So you can see that before World War I, this was pretty small everywhere, less than 10% of national income. Education spending before World War I was less than 0.5% of national income in all European countries. It was almost 1% in the US, which had a big advance at the time, but it was still only 1%. Today, it's 6% of national income. So, you know, it was multiplied by 10 as a share of national income from 0.5 to 6. This is typically the transformation that contributed both to more equality. So, you know, you had a very elitist education system in 1910, much more inclusive in 2020. And, you know, this also contributed to the rise of productivity and, you know, enormous economic growth. And, you know, I think the stagnation in educational investment that we see since the 1980s, 1990s is also probably the best explanation for the stagnation of productivity growth that we've seen since then. It's particularly in a context where you have a big rise in the fraction of a population going to higher education. This stagnation means a huge reduction in per capita higher education investment. And you know, there are issues about health spending, which we could discuss, but just to say that, you know, this stabilization that we have since the 1980s, 1990s, I think is problematic in many ways, in particular for education and health. But, you know, in the long run, you know, this big rise, you know, is responsible both for the decline in inequality and for a large part of our collective prosperity through the accumulation of human capital in education and health. Now, this is the evolution of total tax revenue. Everybody had to pay more tax in order to pay for this, not only the richest group, of course. But now, at the same time as you had this big increase in tax revenue, in average aggregate tax rate, you also had an enormous increase in tax progressivity. So, you know, this is a famous story. But, you know, if you look at the evolution of the top income tax rate, you know, you can see the U.S., for instance, you know, in the U.S. between 1930 and 1980, the average top income tax rate was 81%, which this is only the federal top income tax rate. You also have the state income tax. Now, this did not destroy U.S. capitalism. You know, otherwise, we would have noticed it. Probably because in the end, what matters for economic development is not so much to have huge inequality with income gaps of, you know, 1 to 100 or whatever, but rather, you know, education, and in particular the US in the middle of the 20th century were at a big educational advance. You know, they had 90% of a generation going to high school in the 1950s at the time, where it was 20-30% in France or Germany or Japan. And you have to wait until the 1980s, 90s to get the convergence towards the US. And that's, you know, probably the most important explanation for why, you know, the US economy was the dominant economy during the 20th century. And the fact that you had this very high progressive tax rate, you know, did not hurt growth. You know, if you look at the evolution of the top income tax rate in red and the growth rate, per capita national income growth rate in green, you know, you can see that, you know, the top income tax rate following the Reagan decade in the 1980s was divided by two, basically. In principle, you know, the objective was to boost economic growth, to boost innovation. So basically the discourse was, okay, you're going to have maybe more inequality, but you're going to have so much more growth that, you know, average income are going to grow like you've never seen. Average wages are going to grow like you've never seen. Well, you know, what we've seen is a division by two of the growth rate. I'm not saying this is a causal impact, you know, of the decline in the top income tax rate, but you know, I think it has more to do with the stagnation of educational investment, as I said before. But at least what this shows is that, you know, having a low top income tax rate is certainly not a guarantee for having higher innovation and productivity growth. You know, that's quite obvious when you look at that. Now, how can we go further, you know, in the future? If you want, what I argue is that, you know, if we are looking for new targets, you know, I think we need to continue the investment in the social state and the gradual decommodification of the economy through more investment in education, health. If we want more equal distribution of wealth, we have to do, you know, in addition to income redistribution, in addition to basic income and unemployment insurance, etc. So it's not instead of that, but we have to do something like minimum inheritance. So here it's an example where we would have you know, everybody will get 120,000 euros at age 25, 60% of average wealth. If you put a very small amount, like, you know, 10% or 5% of average wealth, you're not going to change the distribution all that much. So you can do it if you want, but then, you know, the impact on the distribution is going to be almost invisible. So you know, you can, okay, I'm not saying that's going to be simple. I'm not saying this is going to happen next week. I'm just saying if you don't do something like that, and if you just say, okay, let's wait for economic growth, market competition to spread the wealth. Okay, the problem is that we've had economic growth for the past two centuries, and you know the bottom 50% wealth share is still 4%. So, I mean, you can also say this is the best we can do, 4% for the bottom 50%. You know, I think there are lots of poor children in the bottom 50% or bottom 90% who would know much better what to do with 100, 200,000 euros than an additional 100 or 200,000 euros for those who receive millions or billions. But, you know, I think it's going to take time. But, you know, I think at some point, you know, this is what we will get. There's also, you know, some discussion about power sharing. Let me take two more minutes to discuss about two things. You know, one is inequality in access to education. So you can see here in the US, so this is work by Rash Shetty, Emmanuel Saez, where you have percentile of parental income and probability to access university. So you can see, you know, that we still have a lot of inequality in access to education. So, you know, we have a more equal education system than 100 years ago, but now the inequalities have at the level of higher education, and this is quite spectacular in the case of the US. Now, you know, you could say, okay, you have high private tuition in the US, that's part of the reason, but even in a public system, so this is for France, you know, this is another way to represent inequality, where I rank individual not by parental income, but by how much they receive in terms of total educational investment, taking into account total public spending from kindergarten to higher education. And so the people at the top are people who go to class préparatoire, grande école, elitist schools, where they will get 200 to 300,000 euros in total public education spending during their career. People at the bottom will be people who exit education at age 17 or 18. People in the middle who receive 100,000 euros will be people going to a normal university curriculum which are quite not very well funded in France. So this is, you know, quite enormous inequality. Now, you know, to conclude with a positive note, this is still better than what we had before. So if you look at the share of total educational investment received by the top 10% of a cohort who receives the largest educational investment, you know, France today looks very equal. And this is the same data as before. You know, the top 10%, they receive only 20%, and the bottom 50%, they receive 35%. So why do you complain? Well, except that the top 10%, of course, they are five times less numerous than the bottom 50%. So in the end, they get a spending which is 2.5-3 times higher than the average spending of the bottom 50. So this is this data. So, but as compared to 1910, where you had a very elitist school system, you know, you can see the enormous evolution. And if you compare to a colonial setting like Algeria 1950, where here I'm using data collected by Denis Cognot and other people working on the history of the French colonial empire, looking at budgetary archives of the time. Basically, you know, so the top 10% were the children of the settlers, of the French and European settlers, who were about 10% of the population. The bottom 90% were the Muslim Algerians, with two completely segregated school systems, like in the south of the US at the same time, except that here the inequality in budget was much, much bigger than in the US South. You know, I'm sorry to say for people in France who believe that segregation is not part of the French history. Here, the level of spending in the school for Europeans and the school for the colonized population was absolutely enormous. You know, like as compared to, you know, France in 1910 looks like a very equal place. Although this was a place where the bottom 90% of the population only go to primary school and never go to secondary or higher education. So this is just to say that, you know, the imagination of government and societies and elite to structure extreme forms of inequality, because of course, when you have this kind of inequality at the level of children and how much you invest in children, you know, this has long consequences for development, you know, which we still have today. So, you know, there's a lot of imagination by the elite to organize extreme inequality. You know, we talked about Sweden before, we talked about France. So I think, you know, no country is in a situation to give lesson to anyone. And, you know, we are not responsible for this, but what we have to remember, to conclude with a more optimistic note, is that in the long run, you know, there's been a tremendous movement toward more equality. But this movement is not over. And, you know, if we think of this enormous inequality in carbon emission, I have shown you before, so I had some more data on inequality of carbon emission, you know, showing basically always the same message, that if you look at the aggregate, North America, Europe, China look a bit similar. But if you look at the large individual emitters, you know, the responsibilities are very different. And you know, it will take a major new step in the direction of more equality if we want to convince lower class and, you know, middle class in the South and in the North, you know, to change their lifestyle and go in the direction of more equality. So let me stop there. Thanks a lot for your attention.
So thank you, Thomas, for a broad-ranging lecture covering many issues. We have some time for questions. So the floor is to the room. And there is a microphone also on the back. So one hand over there. We take the question one by one. Is it okay to start with? Please try to be short with your questions.
Okay. Thank you, Thomas. I just wanted to react to your last point, and it was also your first point, that you can't convince the middle and lower class to change their behavior if they feel like the top 10% are just messing around. How about taking it to a kind of like a higher moral ground level and say, okay, 10% of the people in the country are just a bunch of thieves and there is nothing we can do about that. It doesn't mean that we should not ourselves try to do the best we can. And so just like, you know, still if we change our behavior, it will make a difference for the world, even if we can't change the 10%, so. Mm.
No, you're right, but you know, I'm just saying, you know, it will work better if we can mobilize, you know, okay. You know, but it's, you know, it's as if you were telling me, say, you know, at the time of the French Revolution, the you know, the peasants or, you know, the bottom class should say, okay, you know, the aristocrats don't want to pay tax, you know, there's nothing I can do about it. I'm going to pay tax instead of them to cover the public debt. Yeah, you can say that. You can say that, but you know, at some point, you can also try to get rid of the privileges of, you know, it. So, what I, you know. No, but you know, the problem is, I think, no, Pascal, I have a lot of sympathy for the idea that we should always do, you know, whatever we can, where we are, that's for sure. But then, when you say, you know, I have no hope, this is what I want to react upon, because you know what I've tried to show you is some historical evidence. So these are not dreams, you know, this is history, where you know people in 1910 in Sweden had no hope that the political system will change. You know, people in Algeria in 1950, you know, had no hope. Well, no, in fact, they had hope, both in 1910 and 1950, and in the end, it made a difference. So you know, here I'm talking about real historical processes, and what I'm telling you is that, you know, the most cherished institutions that we have today, including in terms of economic institutions that produce more economic prosperity, came through this political mobilization. And it was not a long time ago. You know, it was 50 years, 100 years ago. And every time, you know, of course, you had lots of people who were saying, no hope, you know, no way. You know, this is not going to happen. Don't do anything. Pay your tax and don't try to... I mean, I'm not trying to caricature what you're saying, but I just want to say, you know, if we go back through time, you know, I think there are reasons to have hope. But then we have to look carefully at how this happened. And in this happened through a lot of political mobilization. So people who, you know, participate to some collective movement, try to write platforms that, you know, are not going to happen right away. You know, when you know, this kind of evolution, you know, when in 1910, you know, if you had told someone in France or in Sweden, okay, this is going to happen, the elite at the time would have told you, but look, you know, this will never happen. This will be a catastrophe. This will be communism. This will be complete bankruptcy of the country. Okay, but in the end, it happened. And it happened, why? Because, you know, you had some platform of, you know, collective movement who tried to put a platform that was not going to be implemented next week or next year or even the next 10 years, which was a long-term goal. And so I think, you know, we should, you know, I don't want to look too naive or idealistic, but I don't want you to be too cynical. You know, I think we need, I'm trying to look at, you know, what happened. And I'm just saying, you know, one of the problem I think is that the, you know, starting in the 80s, 90s, in particular following the fall of communism, you know, there was an era of sort of unlimited faith in, you know, market competition solving all problems. And, you know, we were both of us were young in the 1990s, where you were even younger than me, but I was still young. And we certainly believed more in market competition. Certainly I believed more in market competition in the 1990s that I do today. You know, I think we've gone too far in this sort of unlimited faith in market competition solving all problems. And I think, you know, this sort of stabilization, in particular of the social state that we've had since the 80s, 90s, you know, it's really at the core of some of our difficulties today. And at the same time, you know, I could understand very well in the 1990s the argument for this stabilization, and I was repeating this argument myself all the time. And so, you know, I have some sympathy for this argument, you know, the idea that you have to stop at some point, you have to stop at some point, and let's stop right there. But the more I think about it, the more I feel, you know, there's something wrong in this reasoning. And that, in fact, no, you know, if you stop there with the progress in higher education and you go from a situation where, you know, you had 20% of a generation going to higher education in the 80s and 60% today, and that's good. You know, there are some countries like Korea has already 70% of a generation going to higher education. So you certainly don't want to restrict access. But if you keep the same total budget, and, you know, same problem for health. You know, if you stabilize the health budget as a fraction of total national income, given all the progress in top-end medical technology in the hospitals, you're going to have to cut somewhere else. And that's what you do. You know, the number of general practitioners in France, you know, has declined by 30% in the past 10 years. People in the rural area don't find a doctor. That's not good from any viewpoint, because then, you know, if you don't put the public resources, you will have private resources, which, as you know very well, will be not only very unequally distributed in terms of access to education and health, but also in many cases not efficiently spent. You know, if you take, you know, the US today puts nearly, I think now it's 18 or 19%, close to 20% of GDP in the health sector in the US. You know, we were accustomed to 12, 13, 14%, but, you know, this was 10, 20 years ago. Now it's getting close to 20% of GDP with very, very bad health indicators. So in terms of competitiveness of the US economy, you know, spending 20% of your GDP for very bad health indicators, you know, is this useful for anyone? So, that's certainly useful for those who provide these health services at very high price, but, you know, in terms of public interest and general economic interest. So I think, you know, if you don't increase the public mobilization of resources, but then that's going to be difficult with a very unequal tax system where, you know, the middle class feels that they are paying less than Elon Musk or Jeff Bezos. So I think this is where, you know, tax progressivity was important. And we are back to the discussion before. And so, I think we should not be too cynical. And, you know, I think the profession, you know, the economics profession has played quite an important role in the rise of cynicism, you know, in the recent decades. Basically saying, you know, that's impossible, this will never happen. And maybe sometime also there are good reasons why we have to stop exactly there. And, except that many people in the profession would have said the same 100 years ago. We have to stop exactly there, you know, below 10%. So, yeah, I think we have to be also, you know, take seriously our collective responsibility in this discussion.
Mm-hmm. Other questions?
Thanks, Thomas. I have a question about, so your optimism is welcome, but we are in a world of low growth compared to, you know, the time that you're comparing to, and probably also relatively lower potential growth for a number of reasons. And also we have been observing a decline in equality of opportunity and social mobility. So the story of the social elevator and basically a decline in trust. And when you ask people, do you think that your children will fare better than you? The answer is no, and there is mistrust in government, etc. So all of this from a political economy perspective doesn't bode very well for sharing the fruits of growth where growth is very limited, etc., etc. So that is a little bit of a trade. I'm not an Ayatollah of growth. That's not the point. But just the point that where you have little growth to start with and people are mistrusting governments, it's probably much more difficult to achieve redistribution because also of the lack of opportunities that you have in the market itself and the sense of unfairness. So you're not really ready to share. You see what? So that's my point. Do you have views on that? I mean, I personally think that this is a problem and I don't have a solution to it, but I think this is a problem. Thanks.
No, I agree with you. It's a problem. It's complicated, but you know, it's always been complicated. That's my main answer, which is, you know, the time when all of this started, you know, growth in the late 19th century, early 20th century was very small, you know, at most 1% per year in European countries or less. And then World War One, the interwar, World War Two, you know, were periods of complete despair and complete catastrophe. And you know, still you had this buildup of a new form of political movement and evolution. So, you know, I think mobilization can be, you know, can come from in times of high growth. It can also come in times of, you know, hardship, you know, to confront the difficulties that we have to face. And also when you're saying, you know, growth today is less high, you know, of course, that's true for rich countries. It's not true, you know, in India, in China, in the South in general. And, you know, I think, you know, some of the change in the future will have to come from the South. You know, I'm not saying, you know, everything is going to come from the North. You know, I think it's important that political movements in the North, you know, make proposal for more, you know, international sharing of fiscal resources. You know, I think well, we will talk about that probably this afternoon at the panel discussion with you, Arseta, you know, I think what we've done with the minimum tax on corporation last year, you know, it's interesting because, 2 years ago, well, it's still not really implemented, but it's interesting, except that, well, it's not still implemented. The minimum tax rate, 15%, is very small on the profits of corporations. There are lots of ways to get around it. And even most importantly, so far, it's been very much a north-north game. So it's more north, countries in the north are sort of sharing the sum of the tax base that's located in tax haven between them, and that's very little from the south. And I think, you know, it's important, of course, that some people in the North say that and that some political movements in the North contribute to, you know, proposal for, say, international tax reform, which will give a share of the tax, a decent share of the tax revenue on multinational billionaires, etc., to the countries in the South. But, you know, this will not come only from the North. This will come mostly from, you know, countries in the South, you know, making clear that this is what they want, and that, you know, if you don't give that to us, well, you know, we will make deals with China, with Russia, we will do other things, we will, you know, at some point, you know, I think the balance of power will change in the world. And basically, if Western countries don't behave differently with respect to sharing such resources, you know, things are going to get really bad. So, you know, I'm not saying things are going to happen nicely and through nice public deliberation. You know, I have some hope in the power of deliberation and writing books, and otherwise I will not do it. But I'm not completely, you know, naive about everything. You know, I think in the end, balance of power effect and will matter a lot, as they did in the past, both at the domestic level, you know, through class struggle at the domestic level, and at the international geopolitical level. You know, the threat of the Soviet Union during the 20th century played a big role on the elite accepting this in the West. The threat of, you know, China, Russia, you know, can play a big role on the North accepting to share with the South a bit more in the future, and hopefully a lot more. But, you know, that's not going to happen just nicely and, you know, asking politely to tax havens and billionaires, would you like to pay a little more tax? You know, look, this cannot happen like this. Things never happen like this. You know, aristocrats don't suddenly say, okay, I'm going to give up my privileges. You know, this cannot happen like this. So this comes through balance of power. You know, just to conclude on this, I think the growing environmental catastrophe that are going to happen, you know, can change the perceptions of what needs to be done to transform the economic system much more quickly than we imagine today. You know, I think so far, you know, of course, it's getting worse every summer with the fires, etc. But it's still, you know, for many people, it's still not sufficiently visible. And at some point, unfortunately, it's going to become very visible. And then, you know, attitudes toward towards the working of the economic system, inequality, and you know, people taking private jets to go everywhere, etc. You know, I think can change quite fast.
You talk about a long run evolution of equality, but we saw in the data of income equality and wealth equality, in particular in wealth equality, that in the late 80s there has been like a big shift. And don't you think that and we know that this shift is due to also a big political shift in Western Europe, and don't you think that these data show us that it is a bit like problematic to talk about a long time evolution of equality now, because we saw that there is a trend that is changing and has changed due to a particular political evolution, and so that we have to consider really this point in order to talk also about the importance of political mobilization.
Thank you very much. So as you highlighted, the progress towards social equality have been made through a different extent of violence, from soft mobilization to world wars or civil wars. And so even though these events were kind of violent, they led to a pretty long-term evolution towards more inequality. And so I was wondering, in our times in which we need to act very fast in order to solve especially the environmental crisis, do you think there is a path towards more equality that wouldn't imply any extent of violence or violent-less or violent-soft option?
Nobody knows. I'm going to start with I think nobody knows the answer to this question, because in the end it depends. You know, this is not a deterministic process. You know, it depends. You know, on all of us. It depends on what everybody does, and collectively, you know, there are lots of bifurcation points where things can change in one way or another. So, what I want to say is that if you look at the history of how you have more equality in the long run, you know, wars are and catastrophic events like wars, you know, are certainly not necessary, and they are not sufficient. You know, they can deliver monsters, they can deliver sometimes more egalitarian political movement, but you know, if you look at the outcome of World War One, World War Two, you know, it can go really in every direction. So we should certainly not say, okay, well, that's the only you know, point where things are going to change positively. I think, as I tried to make clear with the example of Sweden, which is a country that was very little affected by World War I, World War II, as compared to France or Germany. You know, this did not prevent this evolution from happening, because the most important factor was more domestic political force. Now, it depends what you call violence. You know, if you're saying that people who demonstrate in the street, you know, the working class in Sweden demonstrating in the street, it's violent. You know, the problem is that people who are in control write constitutions so that they can never be changed. That's like that. So if you take the example of Sweden, you know, there was no plan in the very unequal constitution in 1910 to change it to universal suffrage. It was not in the plan. So you cannot respect the previous constitution to get universal suffrage in the same way that you cannot respect the Ancien Régime constitution to get to a republic. You know, at some point, you know, all this change at some point, yeah, involve political mobilization and political trajectories that were not planned before. And that were not written in the law written by people who didn't want to give up their power. So by construction, so if you call this violence, well, you know, every constitutional change in France, for instance, you know, since the French Revolution was done outside the rules planned by the previous constitution. And you know, I'm not saying that to say it's not important and it's good. I'm just saying that just to be aware that this is the historical record. And that in the end, it didn't work so badly, in the sense that, you know, the country today as compared to 200 years ago. And so, yeah, it takes big political change, and that's difficult to do sometimes through the existing rules of the game. Now, finishing with your question about can we talk about this long-run movement toward more equality today, given that, you know, starting in the 1980s, 1990s, you have this rise in inequality. I understand what you mean, but I think taking this long-run perspective is important, because it puts this recent period in a broader context. And you can see that in the long run, you know, even in terms of wealth inequality, there was progress toward more equality. I mean, it's quite clear on this picture, you know, the green curve and the blue curve. And so what happened since the 1980s is important, but should not be exaggerated. And I guess that's the main message, you know, that I want to push here, is that, yes, you know, after the fall of the Soviet Union, after, you know, lots of factors, there was this period of sort of unlimited faith in market competition to solve every problem. And you know, I think the sort of Reagan decades, Thatcher decades, you know, did indeed, you know, push toward more equality, even more so in the US, UK than in a country like France, but also in a country like France. But, you know, first, it should not be exaggerated. And first, you know, the whole point of, you know, this historical research is to realize that, you know, this, you know, this historical era, you know, has not been there forever, is not going to be there forever. And I think, you know, people have already realized this. You know, I think since the 2008 financial crisis, you know, people have, you know, have realized that, you know, the sort of pure neoliberal era of the 1990s and early 2000s is sort of over, you know, in a way, and with the 2020 pandemic and also the 2008 financial crisis, you know, people have realized how much, you know, the public, you know, bailout of private capitalist firm, public support in times of huge crises was absolutely indispensable. And so perceptions of the role of the state and perception of how much you can let market competition solve everything, you know, have started to change. But, you know, we're still far from building a sort of new vision of where we want to go in the long run. And so, you know, that's what I'm trying to contribute a little bit to by putting this historical evidence together. But, you know, of course, this will have to be a collective process, and, you know, there's a long way to go.
That's a good conclusion, hopefully. Thank you very much, Thomas, again.
Thanks a lot.